Welcome to Boston Harbor. Around this corner there are 50 colonists approaching, who have set their minds on throwing 45 tons of tea into the water. And here, we have a terribly outnumbered guard who will try and stop the whole thing from happening. But let us pause here for a moment. You're about to witness the historical event of the Boston Tea Party. But before, let's get you up to date. At the beginning of it all stood the signing of the Treaty of Paris in February 1763, which ended the Seven Years' War, also known as the French and Indian War. The years of fighting had been very expensive and left Britain with a debt of £130 million. Nevertheless, the Crown found it necessary to have 7,500 troops stationed in America, even in a state of peace. The Empire was convinced that Spain and France would recover from their losses during the war and would try to win some of the colonies back. However, financing an army that big was expensive. To try and make the colonies pay for the soldiers, the Crown and British Parliament made it out as though the army was simply needed for the colonists' own protection. Unsurprisingly, the colonists disagreed. Britain's plan was to put taxes on various goods the colonies imported. Therefore, Parliament passed the Sugar Act in 1764, 1 year later the Stamp Act, and in 1765 the Quartering Act. All acts resulted in great protests by the colonists, and due to their boycotts turned out to be rather unsuccessful. No taxation without representation is a well-known phrase that originates from the conflict created by Britain's America policy. Colonists claimed that without representatives in British Parliament, the Crown was in no position to tax them. Back to Boston. The city was an area that turned out to be very difficult for the British from the very start. Just one example showing this is the Boston Massacre of 1770, when a crowd of Bostonians, angered by the presence of the troops and Britain's colonial policy, began harassing a group of soldiers. It got to May 1773 until another conflict arose. The British East India Company had been close to bankruptcy because colonial smuggling and non-consumption had taken a heavy toll on the company. The company was important to Britain as a big league taxpayer, so to prevent them from failing, Parliament passed the Tea Act. The Tea Act did not impose new taxes on American colonies. Tax on tea had already existed, but it eliminated all import duties on tea entering England and permitted the company to sell tea directly to its customers rather than going through wholesalers, which reduced the tea price a lot, well below the price of all smuggled competition. Furthermore, the company had a legal and government-sanctioned monopoly on tea. American colonists, angered by the undercutting of colonial merchants and the monopoly on tea for the East India Company, also saw the Tea Act as a law that threatened to corrupt Americans into accepting the principle of parliamentary taxation by taking advantage of their weakness for a frivolous luxury. That was why committees of correspondence in the colonies decided to prevent East India cargoes from being landed. However, on November 28, the strategy failed when the Dartmouth made it into Boston Harbor, followed by two more ships not long after. The colonists, especially the Sons of Liberty, a group of young, enthusiastic patriots that originated from protests against the Stamp Act, threatened the captain of the Dartmouth, Francis Roche, to stop the ship from getting unloaded. Similarly, Thomas Hutchinson, loyalist and governor of Massachusetts, wouldn't let the ships leave before they paid their duties, insisting to prevent the ship from leaving by using force if necessary. This brings us back to the evening of the 16th of December 1773. A crowd of 5,000 Bostonians had gathered at Old South Church and sent Captain Roche to Governor Hutchinson to ask for permission to let the three ships leave without paying duties. When Hutchinson declined, 50 young men stepped forward and dressed as Mohawk Indians, symbolizing a virtuous, proud and assertive American identity, distinct from that of corrupt Britain, and headed for the wharf, followed by most of the crowd. Once there, they violently forced their way onto the ships and...
This is fake news put out by the media.
Well, for once he's actually right. The men assaulted nobody and damaged nothing but the cargo. It lasted almost an hour, and thousands of onlookers stood silently transfixed, as if it was a religious service. They watched hatches break and open wooden chests, and 45 tons of tea be thrown into the water. When finished, the participants left quietly, but not before they had cleaned the ships. Later known as the Boston Tea Party, the events of that night served as an example for many more riots in American colonies. Merchants with English tea got forced to burn it, and some colonists wrecked an inn because the innkeeper sold East India Company's tea. As a reaction to the Tea Party, Britain closed Boston Harbor and limited the colony's freedom with laws. In 1744, America held the first Continental Congress to reach more independence from the Empire. The Boston Tea Party had set off the process of secession and independence from Britain.
Are you going to the party? Going to the Boston Tea Party? Going to the party? Going to the Boston Tea Party?
Oh dear, this doesn't taste nice. It's rather salty.
Going to the Boston Tea Party.